God's goodness and don't give up. Why does the man in Jesus' prayer illustration keep talking? Two reasons. He knows his friend hurt him. He knows his friend has prayed. So why should we pray without giving up? We know God hears our prayers and that he is able to provide for us. When we keep seeking him and knocking, we show trust in his faithfulness. In the first reading, Abraham intercedes for Sodom and Gomorrah, asking the Lord to save the city. Even 10 righteous people are found there. Paul writes to the Colossians and encourages them to trust the grace of baptism, take away sins, and give life. In the gospel, Jesus teaches his disciples to pray. He tells them to ask, seek, and knock.
And let us please stand together. And let us please sing together Psalm 561. 10,000 reasons.
Thank you. love you, Lord, granting us firm foundation, nothing is holy. Bestow in abundance your mercy upon us, and grant that in you, as our ruler and guide, we may use the good things that pass in such a way as to hold us even now. In to those that ever endure. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Genesis. In those days, the Lord said, the outcry against Sodom and Gomorrah is so great, and their sin so grave, that I must go down and see whether or not their actions fully correspond to the cry against them that comes to me. I need to find out. While Abraham's visitors walked on farther towards Sodom, the Lord remained standing before Abraham. Then Abraham drew nearer and said, will you sweep away the innocent with the guilty? Suppose there were 50 innocent people in the city. Would you wipe out the place rather than spare it for the sake of the 50 innocent people within it? Far be it from you to do such a thing, to make the innocent die with the guilty, so the innocent and the guilty would be treated alike. Should not the judge of all the world act with justice? The Lord replied, if I find 50 innocent people in the city of Sodom, I will spare the whole place for their sake. Abraham spoke up again, see how I am presuming to speak to my Lord, though I am but dust and ashes. What if there are five less than innocent people? Will you destroy the whole city because of those five? He answered, I will not destroy it if I find 45 there. But Abraham persisted, saying, but if only 40 are found there? He replied, I will forbear doing it for the sake of the 40. Then Abraham said, let not my Lord grow impatient if I go on. But if only 30 are found there? He replied, I will forbear doing it if I can combine the 30 of it. Still Abraham went on, since I have thus dared to speak to my Lord, what if there are no more than 20 of them? The Lord answered, I will not destroy it for the sake of the 20. But still he persisted, please let not my Lord grow angry if I speak up this last time. What if there are at least 10? He replied, for the sake of those 10, I will not destroy it. The word of the Lord.
Amen.
Thank you. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Colossians. Brothers and sisters, you were buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through faith in the power of God, who raised him from the dead. And even when you were dead in transgressions and uncircumcision of your flesh, he brought you to life along with him, having forgiven all our transgressions, obliterating the bond against us with his legal claims, which was opposed to us. He also removed it from our midst, nailing it to the cross. The word of the Lord.
I once heard a Christian comedian speaking about this story from the Old Testament. I think it may have been Ken Davis, and he was talking about how Abraham argues with God over the fate of Sodom and Gomorrah, whittling him down little by little, saying to God, what if only 50 righteous can be found? Well, how about 40, maybe 30? And the comedian says, can you imagine having a father like Abraham? Can you imagine if you were Isaac and you went to Father Abraham and you said, hey, Dad, can I have $50? He said Abraham's response might have been something like this. $40? Why do you need $30? I'm not going to give you $20. I'll give you $10. It's a funny story, but it makes a good point. And that is, Abraham wasn't afraid to bargain with God. He wasn't afraid to negotiate with God on behalf of others, to intercede for them, invoking God's mercy and his justice. The story of Sodom and Gomorrah appears not only in the Hebrew Torah, but also in the Islamic Quran. It is a well-known cautionary tale throughout the ancient world. And when we read the story in its entirety, it's easy for us to focus our attention on the wickedness and the grave sin which is occurring in Sodom and Gomorrah, on the two angels sent by God to destroy unrepentant sinners, the divine messengers of judgment who call down fire and brimstone from the skies. And indeed, the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah have become, for us, bywords of destruction and desolation, a warning of the judgment of God that is repeated frequently throughout both the Old and the New Testament scriptures. In fact, Sodom and Gomorrah have become such an enduring image of God's judgment that the term fire and brimstone was coined and eventually applied to preachers in the early 18th century who used vivid descriptions of judgment and eternal damnation to try and frighten their flocks into repentance. The early American preacher Jonathan Edwards began the first great awakening with a sermon entitled Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God, preaching to his congregation, divine justice says of the tree that brings forth such grapes of Sodom, cut it down. Why should it be wasting the soil? The sword of divine justice is at every moment brandished over their heads, and it is nothing but the hand of arbitrary mercy and God's mere will that holds it back. Now, I don't want to minimize today the fact that judgment does indeed await us if we persevere in grave sin. That is one of the takeaways of this story. But when I read the passage today, I see another side to the story. Unlike Edwards, I don't see an arbitrary mercy. Rather, I see Abraham negotiating with God, who agrees to spare the cities for the sake of just 10 righteous people. Granted, these cities probably only contained about 1,000 or so people, but we're still talking about a God who is willing to spare them if fewer than 1% of the population can be found to be righteous. And when not even 10 can be found, he nonetheless sends his angels to rescue Lot and his family from the impending destruction, with the angels physically dragging them from the city in order to save them. And if you read the full account, you quickly come to realize that not even Lot and his family were righteous. Rather, God shows them his unmerited favor and grace. It is as the apostle says in our second reading, even when you were dead in transgressions, he brought you to life along with him, having forgiven us all our transgressions, obliterating the bond against us with its legal claims, which was opposed to us. He also removed it from our midst, nailing it to the cross. This is not arbitrary mercy. Rather, this is mercy that is willing to revive the dead in order that they may be saved, literally resurrecting us for the sake of our redemption and our liberation. This is a mercy which is willing to drag us, if possible, from our environment of sin and the coming consequences of that sin. But we don't always cooperate with God's graces, do we? How many times do we, like Lot's wife, turn back towards our sin, or to the way of life we've always known, resisting God's grace, opposing His mercy, and instead choosing judgment for ourselves. In today's Gospel, St. Luke gives us an abbreviated version of the Lord's Prayer, teaching us to ask God for His forgiveness daily, and asking that He would not subject us to the final test. In other words, we are asking God for His mercy. Pope Emeritus Benedict, in his book, Jesus of Nazareth, writes, "Normally, our thought precedes our words. Our thought seeks and formulates the word. But in liturgical prayer, it is exactly the other way around. The word, the voice, goes ahead of us, and our minds must adapt to it. God has come to our aid. He Himself provides the words of our prayer and teaches us how to pray. When we pray the Our Father, we are praying to God with the words given to us by God. In presenting our petitions to God through the Lord's Prayer, we are making the very requests of God that He Himself wishes to grant. In the rest of the Gospel passage, Jesus begins to teach His disciples the value of persistent prayer, telling the story of a man who goes to his friend's house at midnight asking for bread. The bread that he asks for is not for himself, but for another friend who has come, perhaps unexpectedly, from a journey and has also arrived late at night. It sounds a bit convoluted, but it's Jesus' story, not mine. He has just taught his disciples to pray for their daily bread, and now he tells the story of a man who goes to a friend's house asking for bread, and the friend attempts to turn him away. After all, it's no longer the daily bread. The day is done. There will be more bread tomorrow. But notice what our Lord says, yet because of his persistence. Notice too that like Abraham in the Old Testament reading, the man's persistence is on behalf of someone else. He is interceding for his friend who has just arrived from a long journey. Augustine even suggests that perhaps this friend comes from a bad road or an evil life, weary and not finding the truth. And so perhaps, like Abraham, we are being presented with an opportunity to go before the Lord and ask for God's mercy and grace on someone else's behalf, to return to them with bread from heaven, given to us by God Himself. In the Lord's Prayer, we are instructed to ask for our daily bread, but when we come before God in prayer, it doesn't matter what time it is. It doesn't matter if it's morning or noon or even the middle of the night. As St. Ambrose says, we have here another kind of command given us, that at all times, not only in the day, but at night, prayer should be offered up. Thankfully, God doesn't keep regular working hours. He makes Himself always available to us, commanding us to ask, to seek, to knock. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks, the door will be opened. God is the good Father who desires to give good gifts to His children, but He also wants for us to be persistent in our prayers. In today's readings, we find that there's a lot for us to consider. The reality of great sin and God's coming judgment. The example of persistent intercessory prayer, both for ourselves and for others. The reality of a loving Father who is willing to do everything possible in order to save us, resurrecting us when we are dead in our transgressions, forgiving our sins, and even giving us the very words to use when asking for His mercy and grace, all the while encouraging us to be persistent in our petitions. And then today's Gospel ends with these words, "If you then, who are wicked, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him?" In the gift of the Holy Spirit, the Father has given us everything that is necessary to live a life free from sin and able to respond to God's mercy and grace. It is as St. Peter writes, His divine power has given us everything needed for life and godliness through the knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and goodness. Thus He has given us through these things His precious and very great promises, so that through them we may escape from the corruption that is in the world because of lust, and may become participants in the divine nature.
Thank you.
Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you. Fruits of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed
be God. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and the glory of his name, for our good and for all his holy church.
Accept, O Lord, we pray, the offerings which we bring from the abundance of your gifts, that through the powerful working of your grace, this most sacred mystery, we sanctify our present way of life, and lead us to eternal gladness, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Do this in memory of me. ministry of prayer. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Ivan, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray. That with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, the Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the Blessed Apostles, and all the saints who have been throughout the ages, we will dare to be glorious eternal life, and we praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in thy unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Thank you.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who go to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy to be entered under my roof, but only say the word of my soul shall be healed. And may the body and blood of Christ give us faith for eternal life. Thank you.
This morning. The Auburn Interfaith Food Closet will be distributing bags of needed food items today at 5 p.m. on the church plaza. If you or anyone you know is in need of food donations, please stop by. No questions are asked and no identification is required. We will soon begin installing security cameras, around the parish property. This is part of the safety planning the diocese is asking all parishes to begin implementing. The Religious Education Office will host its parent information meeting this Tuesday, July 26th at 6:30 p.m. in the Beatitude Room. Parents are strongly encouraged to attend a parent information meeting either this Tuesday or in August. Details are in the bulletin. Faith formation registration forms will be provided at the information meeting. And finally, our religious education program is also in need of volunteers. So please prayerfully consider that.
His perpetual memorial of the passion of your Son. Grant, we pray, that this gift which he himself gave us with love beyond all telling may profit us for salvation through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And the Lord be with you.
And
with
your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless everyone, the Father and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Mass is ended. Let us go in peace.
Thanks.